Hey guys. Hey guys. So I wanted to talk a little bit about my experience over here in terms of using magic mushrooms. And I think it's really helpful because more and more it's being used in research as a way to heal trauma and PTSD symptoms. And I definitely have been diagnosed with PTSD multiple times. So it's something that I found a couple of times a year can really be nice and helpful and useful to shut down your emotional system, relax you, and help with creative thinking in order to create new neural pathways so that you put your life into greater perspective and your experiences into greater perspective. And it definitely has that sense of relief for the symptoms as well. So what's been really interesting is in this past experience with using magic mushrooms, I found that it was really grounding, and I would like to share my experience with you because I think it's kind of funny as well. So this time I was like, hey, I'm going to have it in the forest by a lake. And so I take it in the forest and I start making my way to the lake. And then suddenly, like as the mushrooms started getting digested, I felt like really tired and out of breath, and I couldn't really walk to the lake anymore. And I was like, oh no, like I guess I just have to sit over here. And a part of me was like, you know, should I have this mushroom experience by the lake? Like, what's really the best way to do it? Would it be by the lake? Would it be in my cabin? Would it be just by the river? And I had like these three choices, and it was kind of like tormenting me because I have this habit of like ruminating and having loop thinking. And that's part of like my brain, right? I just have that thinking pattern. And so it was coming into play here where I was like, oh, I can't really sit down here in the middle of the forest. I really have to be either, you know, at one of these three locations, and I'm not sure which would be the best decision. Anyway, so I'm ruminating about where to really, you know, have this whole mushroom experience. But meanwhile, I can't really walk. So I sit down in the middle of this path in the forest, and I realize I'm like, okay, I'm ruminating. Like, you know, let this go. And I was like, if the universe wants me to have my mushroom experience here, like just in the middle of the path in the forest, like not really anywhere, I'm just in between all three of my choices, then that's fine. And then as I'm sitting there, I'm like, oh, this is a metaphor for life. I was like, this is a way to kind of put into perspective that sometimes we're not meeting any of our goals, and we're on this random path that we never in a million years thought we'd end up on. And we're like nowhere near where we wanted to go, but we're doing something weird and different. And to me, I was like, well, you know, I think that's kind of a metaphor. Sometimes you just end up in random places, and that's where you're supposed to end up. So it just made me feel like life is a journey, and sometimes you're on a path that you didn't choose, but that's a part of your journey, and that's where you're meant to be. So you're meant to be on this random path right now. And so I was like, okay, you know, that's cool. And so the colors start getting more intense, and like, oddly enough, every time I saw a mushroom in the forest, it was as if this like mushroom alien had possessed me, and I was really drawn to the other mushrooms. It's like being possessed by an alien somehow, where you like really just go up to the other mushrooms and you're like, wow, you're beautiful. It was as if the mushrooms in me was kind of saying hi to the mushrooms in the forest. And I was laughing at that. That was a hilarious thought. I was really amused by it. And then actually some more profound moments happened where I realized that, okay, if I'm on this path that, you know, I'm on, I've just been put on this path and I can't really go anywhere because I can't really hike right now. And what happens if in life you are on this path and you're kind of waiting for things to happen. So, you know, in life we always make things happen and we achieve and we work towards our goals and we climb steps and we climb ladders. But I think it's also so much a part of our culture and so much a part of our society to be like, I'm going to reach this mecca. I'm going to reach my goal. I'm going to achieve this amazing thing and meet this amazing person and have these mind-blowing friends and do all these fascinating things. And like, I think a big part of just being stuck on that path was like, maybe nothing mind-blowing is going to happen. You know, like, it's okay. It's okay to just be an earthling on earth with the ants and the forest mice, and we're on earth and we're all people, and I think we're all sold this like massive dream of making it and of success, and I think a lot of people, like, when they get there, they're just like, I feel myself but I have more money, or I feel myself and now I reach this goal but I realize that I have another 10 goals to reach. And I think it was really humbling, and it gave me a lot of perspective into being like, I need to adjust my expectations for meeting my goals, because I think that, you know, the whole dream of the white picket fence or living happily ever after, all this bullshit that we've been taught since we were little, even though logically, you know, it's not true, there's that kind of emotional expectation for, whoa, I'm going to meet this amazing thing and this amazing thing's going to happen. And just adjusting our expectations and being like, no, like, you'll make your future and you'll have some decent possibilities and some decent options, and you can choose your decent options. And sometimes you end up with decent friends and decent people and decent partners, and you have a decent house. And part of that was really just really grounding. And I was like, you know what? I think that I definitely was sold into that fairy tale ending that society kind of raised us with subconsciously, or that American dream type of mentality where you're always like, wow, you know, I'm going to have this great, massive, life-changing thing happen. But then, yeah, it's really just grounding to be like, no, you know, sometimes you're on a path and you're on the path of life and you're hoping for nice options, for decent options, but nothing is going to absolutely blow your mind and come in and change your life, because life is life and that's okay. And I think that was just really humbling. And then another really interesting realization I had was I started thinking back to this 70-year-old man who I met over here. And something that was really just beautiful about him is he told stories, and he had such an interesting life. He was a truck driver for like most of his life, and just being a truck driver and being in nature and doing his own thing, he has the most fascinating, mind-blowing stories. And I was like, wow, you know, here's a 70-year-old man, and I always thought you had to like have three companies and like, you know, won the lottery and went to all of these places in the world. But he's just a trucker, and he just tells his stories, and he knows so much, and he's so wise and funny, and he's awesome. And I think what inspired me about him actually was something from within myself, that I realized that I stopped talking about my experiences and I stopped telling my stories because it was a result of trauma. And as a woman and as someone who went through trauma, you slowly, unfortunately, have the experience of not being listened to and of not being heard and of being ignored. And even experiences of me calling the police and the police were just laughing, you know, and stuff like that, where you're like, whoa, I really, like, what's the point of talking? What's the point of telling my story? What's the point of sharing? The point of sharing my experiences? And so I think that during that trip, it really just dawned on me that I was inhibiting my voice and my stories and my experiences, because I just thought, you know what, it doesn't matter to anybody what happens to me or what I think or what I say. And that was just a part of the trauma. And that really, like, I almost burst out crying when I had that like profound, deep realization of I stopped talking. I did stop talking. I stopped telling my stories. And that's what this man really taught me. And I really was able to feel that lesson on that trail in the forest. And that was really grounding. And the other major thing that came up was, and this is the whole time, I also like, since I have this kind of ruminating mentality, I'm like thinking about business a lot and investments and just trying to figure out my next step. And so all throughout this trip, I'm trying to like I'm tuning into to what's happening, but then bam, I'll have this intrusive thought of like, oh, what should I do about this investment? And so it kept kind of coming up. And so by the end of the trip, I was like, you know what? There's one more thing that I want to address. And I think what I had never addressed was not self-confidence, because I do have confidence in myself, but I think like anybody could be better. But what I addressed was, do I think I'm beautiful? And it's interesting because I think as a woman, you're so used to getting unwanted attention, and that's supposed to make you feel beautiful. Like, oh, you know, if somebody whistles at me, then I guess I'm beautiful. Or, but it's very rare, I think, to truly be in love with yourself and to be like in admiration of yourself and to be like, wow, I'm an amazing person. And I find that that's come into play with my relationships, because if I ever had a partner who was like, wow, you're beautiful and you're an amazing person, I was just like, meh, probably, it's cool. You know, like I didn't really feel it. Like it didn't come, like that feeling just wasn't there for me. And I was like, well, that's nice of you to say, you know? And so during this trip, it's something that kind of really dawned on me, where I'm like, I've never been able to take that in because I just don't feel it. And I just don't like think that really. And so I did this exercise where I was, chose a patch of grass to be like, imagine that you were looking at a clone, like another version of yourself, and she was sitting there and she started talking to you about who she was and what she did and what she's been through and a little bit more like about herself. Would you like that person? What would you think she's interesting? Do you want to hang out with her? And I stood there for a long time looking at that patch of grass and imagining me, but in another person, but just getting to know me. And then trying to, or slowly getting to the point where I'm like, yeah, I could see how that person is beautiful, and I could see how that person is interesting, and I could see hanging out and having fun with that person. And I was like, okay. And I thought I did my work. I was like, okay, that's interesting. Like it wasn't completely there, but I was getting in touch with it. And by that time, the mushrooms were slowly wearing off, and it had been a few hours. And so I started making my way out of the forest. And then all these business questions started coming back into my head. And I'm like, no, I am not ending my mushroom trip on business intrusive thoughts. So I was like, Tanya, you are turning around and walking right back into that forest, and you're going to look at that girl one more time, and you're going to do the work. And so I walked back into the forest and I was like, I'm going to find her again. And so I walked back in and I went back to the same patch of grass and I found her again and I focused. And I just really sat for as long as I could, dwelling on the version of me that I would be able to admire as a second person, as an outsider, so that I can feel those feelings of admiration for myself, or those feelings of beauty, or those feelings of love within myself, so that not only can I have that gift, but it's also when other people come in and they're like, oh, wow, you know, what an amazing person, or you're so beautiful. It's something that I can actually take in, because I can feel that, because I know that feeling, and because I actually I'm like, yeah, you know, I know that feeling, and thank you. I appreciate you recognizing that within me, you know. And that was a really interesting exercise that I had never done before. And that was me battling with myself in the forest. And yeah, so that was that. And I did get lost in the forest at the end. Thank goodness, like, it had worn off, because at a certain point, I like came to the end of the path, and I was like, oh, it should be like right to the right, you know. So I started walking to the right. I went off the path, and then there were just all forest around me. And I heard, thank goodness, I heard a family, and they're like, Dee, Snuff, Reed. They're like hiding. They were playing hide and seek, and I was like following their voices for the life of me. And I ended up on like the other side of the lake of who knows where, and I came up behind their outhouse, and they were kind of just like, how did this person pop in from the woods behind our bathroom out of nowhere? But I just sauntered off as if like it was normal and I belong there somehow. And that was it. That was the story. So I thought that was fun, just a fun thing to discuss and to go over. Yeah. I hope you enjoyed that little experience.